morning, sir. Now, good to see you. Happy New Year.
I wish the same. A very good morning.
Right. I guess a lot of trained students are ready for this morning's lecture.
Thank you very much. Oh, my dear students, reading EDC R242. That's level 300 students. And our cherished listening public in and around Winneba. Good morning and welcome to this morning's presentation on leadership. Our theme for this morning's presentation is leadership theories and styles. And I'm going to be your presenter, Eric Ofosu Jamina, from the Department of Educational Foundations, Faculty of Educational Studies. And I'm being here assisted by Mr. Roger Amwakun, also from the Department of Educational Foundations. So together, we say you are welcome aboard. My dear students, for the next couple of weeks, we shall be looking at leadership theories and styles. And for the purpose and reason of this course, that is EDC R242, we shall present a general overview of leadership theories from classical to modern in a summary manner with a critical perspective. The prominent theories will be presented with their basic assumptions, features, and criticisms in distinct subtitles. By this way, we believe we will make a contribution to leadership, organizational behavior, and management in schools. The theories that we shall be looking at are the Gridman theory, the trait theory, behavioral theory, contingency theory. We shall also look at the three common leadership styles, which are authoritarian, democratic, and laissez-faire. This morning, our learning objectives are as follows: to introduce and critically discuss approaches to leadership that look at the Gridman theory. We shall look at its characteristics and personality of leaders. We also introduce and critically discuss traditional approaches to leadership that look at the trait theory. We look at the characteristics and personality of leaders. You and I will believe that we have leaders everywhere in our lives. Even when we are only two, one of us generally will have to be a leader. From the home through to the most complex organizations, we have leaders. Before starting this lecture, you heard the leader of this university giving us a Christmas message. So we see leadership to be a very complex process, and some people have serious reservations over the extent to which a set of standards, qualities, or competencies can ever fully capture the nature of what makes some leaders successful and others unsuccessful. You might have read a lot about leadership and have come across a whole lot of definitions as regards leadership. But if you read across the definitions, you realize that leadership by nature is a process. It involves influence. It occurs in groups. It involves common goals. And on top, leadership is an intended purpose. When you look at the literature concerning leadership, it shows an evolving series of schools of thought as regards Gridman and trait theories. Whilst early theories tend to focus on the characteristics and behaviors of successful leaders, Later theories begin to consider the role of followers and the contextual nature of leadership. Some of these aspects as regard the theories date back into the 1800s. The most commonly referred to of these theories, much as the literature is concerned, include the Great Man theories of 1840. Then we come down to the 1930s and the 1940s, where we had a revision of the Great Man theory to have the trait theories. From the 1940s to the 1950s, we have the behavioral theorists. And 10 years after, that is 1960, we came to have the contingency theory, followed in 1970 by the transactional theories. Same 1970, we had the transformational theories. And we also identified the situational theories of the 1980s. Our concern this morning, as earlier mentioned, is about the Great Man leadership theory. We look at some characteristics of this theory. Traits of leadership are intrinsic. That is, they are inborn. And we also go on to say that leaders under the Great Man leadership are exceptional people. We saw them to be exceptional people who were born with those innate qualities, and they were destined to lead. Such leaders are basically male. We see them to be muscular. In our local parlance, we say macho. And they were also military-like. Great leaders will rise when confronted with the appropriate situation. We see leaders as heroes who influence individuals due to their wisdom. They may influence individuals maybe due to the charisma that they possess and also their intelligence. Leaders who utilize their power in a way that had a decisive historical impact have come and gone. Even here in this country, Ghana, we've had such people we ascribe as great leaders. We have men like Kwame Nkrumah, Nelson Mandela, Sir Winston Churchill, Benito Mussolini, Adolf Hitler, Franklin Roosevelt. And if we go to the religious side, we may have Muhammad, we may have Jesus Christ also. They were considered great men of their time. So the theory suggests that the anatomy, psychology, and personality of a great man are different from ordinary people. Therefore, according to Spectre 2016, not everyone can be a leader and cannot want to be a leader, because leadership is seen as a gift from God to human beings. More so, the characteristics of a leader are innate. They are inborn and passed through the gene. And for that matter, the Great Man theory can also be called as the genetic theory. As the characteristics are genetic, leadership is something that cannot be learned, and leadership characteristics cannot be acquired afterwards. So a human being either has these characteristics inborn or not. we are looking at the great man theory. There may be some criticisms of this theory. One of which is that heroes are simply the product of their times, and their actions are results of social conditions. And attributing historical events to the decision of individuals was a primitive, it was a childish, and something that wasn't based on any scientific facts. It was actually unscientific. The great man theory actually proposed a gender bias to leadership, that leaders are only men. And anytime you mention great man theory, some people come in to say or ask, why not great women theory? Or is there any theory we refer to as great women theory? But maybe we may have answers to some of these criticisms. More so, leadership doesn't always come from birth, and leadership characteristics can be gained and learned. So this is a criticism to the great man theory. What distinguishes the leader from other people is that the leader has a whole set of congenital and subsequently acquired characteristics. Such criticisms addressed to the great man theory has led to the emergence of another theory that we refer to as the trait theory. The trait theory claims leadership is not only congenital, but a combination of both congenital and acquired characteristics. From the literature, the trait theory is considered as a modification of the great man theory. And accordingly, there is a need to explore the characteristics that make the leader and distinguish a leader from other people. And many researchers have demonstrated various leadership characteristics that explain leadership. In general, height, weight, gender, maturity, openness, persuasion, domination, knowledge, determination, self-confidence, and forward vision are just some of them, according to Harrison, 2018. For example, Mann, 1959, made a list of 1400 features, that is 1400 features, in explaining leadership. More so, Stockdale, 1948, examined leadership studies from 1904 to 1947, and then identified 124 leader characteristics. He then narrowed down and found 8 distinctive leadership characteristics, which he identified as intelligence, intuition, responsibility, and sociability, insistence on dealing with problems, self-confidence, and agility in meeting the needs of others. Even most of the characteristics are acquired later, if you look at the characteristics you have mentioned, but they can also be innate characteristics such as gender and intelligence. In this sense, the trait theory is distinguished from great men theory. It has a universal point of view, as people with certain characteristics are leaders, according to Kirkpatrick and Locke, 1991. Stockdale, 1974, on the other hand, argued that a person with the characteristics doesn't in any way guarantee to be a leader. According to Stockdale, although having certain characteristics doesn't guarantee leadership, the individual is more likely to be an effective leader and has a higher potential. The trait theory has been criticized in similar ways as the great man theory. First, it is emphasized that the assumptions of the theory are speculative, and the theory lacks empirical tests and research. For instance, the theory cannot give a clear descriptive answer to the question of who the leader is. So we see that traits are the qualities or characteristics typically belonging to a person that distinguish him from the other person. And one of the assumptions of the trait theory is that people are either born or made with certain qualities that will make them excel in leadership roles. Such leaders are different from the average person in terms of personality traits such as intelligence, creativity, and ambition. Some people are born with inherited traits, and that puts them in leadership position. It focuses on finding mental, physical, and social characteristics among leaders. Turning on to the criticisms of the trait theory, we realize that the idea that traits are inborn and unchangeable appears to be incorrect, because some of the characteristics the person may exhibit may be modified or changed entirely in later years. It is possible for a person to learn to change his or her good character or traits for a bad or worse one. And for that matter, there is no one particular trait that has been found to make a person a potential leader. As in the great man theory, the trait theory is also criticized for having a narrow perspective. At this point, only leadership characteristics have been put forward in theory, but environmental factors, according to Robbins 2001, such as the group values affecting the leadership and the structure of the task, have not been taken into account. Leadership is not a superficial phenomenon that can only be explained by characteristics. In addition to the lack of empirical texts and research, according to Harrison 2018, there is also inconsistency between the characteristics set forth in the limited studies in trait theory. For example, some studies focus on physical characteristics in explaining leadership, while others focus on internal characteristics such as personality. In addition, the factors that led to the leader's achievement in some studies have led to failure in other studies, according to Fleer 2006. This indicates that the studies are inconsistent in terms of their findings. Furthermore, the theory does not provide clear information for the measurement of characteristics. Intelligence is a leadership trait. For example, but the theory doesn't provide sufficient explanations about the intensity or degree of intelligence required to be a leader. So generally, it is possible to summarize the biggest criticisms of the trait theory as ignoring the environmental conditions and factors that the inconsistency findings in the studies. In addition, the assumptions of great men theory in many sources seem to be the same as the assumptions of trait theory. Although the origin of the theory is based on the great men theory, one mustn't forget that there is, in fact, a difference between them in viewpoints of leadership characteristics. While the great men theory suggests leadership characteristics are innate or they are inborn, the trait theory says that these characteristics can be acquired both in birth and later. This distinction reveals that the two theories are separate theories but have some common assumptions. I will pause here for you to think about some of the common assumptions that you can identify between the trait theory and the great man theory as we pause to await your calls. We are activating the studio lines and the numbers are 050-392-3158. I repeat, 050-392-3158 or 033-232-0201. 033-232-0201. We're waiting for your calls. Yes. Hello. Hello, we are listening to you. Hello? Hello, listener. Right, as we await the calls, let us take a look at some of the key things that we mentioned. Alright, the caller is now in.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, this is Anna Richard.
Go ahead.
Tranmere.
Hello. Yes, we're waiting for the call. We said that some of the assumptions of the great man theory are that the traits leadership or the traits of leadership are intrinsic and leaders are exceptional people who are born with inborn qualities and they are destined to lead. And leaders are basically male, they are muscular, and they are military-like. Great leaders will rise when confronted with the appropriate situation. He also went on. Yes, caller, we are listening. Hello.
Hello, good morning, sir.
Good morning.
This is Frank from the.
Hello.
Hello, Jasmine. Good morning. This is Frank from the English department.
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, so please, with the great man's theory.
Yes.
You said that they believe that leadership qualities are innate and they are born with it. So I want to ask, if a child is born with these innate qualities,
mm-hmm.
and the child is found at a particular environment which would not help the child to exhibit these qualities, would the child still become a leader according to this theory?
Right, thank you very much. Yes, as you heard, we said it's a theory. When, shall I say, a theory of old. People that we have looked at, you realize that some of these people, they emerge due to the situation that they found themselves in at that time. So it will be very difficult to say that this child has been born to me and this child is going to be a leader. It is the characteristics that the child will exhibit. And of course, it will also depend upon that particular environment. Yes, because we do say that in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man turns out to be the superior. Yeah, so it will basically depend upon the environment that we see him. We look at the person's wisdom, the kind of intelligence he's having, the charisma, and the person can push himself forward in terms of need. And of course, we can identify that person as a leader, even right from childhood. We see this person exhibiting some of these characteristics. But that is not all.
Hello.
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 Please, my name is
Can you reduce your volume and then move away from the radio set?
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello, we're listening. All right, so we go on. We have said that traits of leaders are intrinsic. Leaders are exceptional people born with innate qualities and destined to lead. Leaders are basically male, they are muscular and military-like. Great leaders will rise when confronted with the appropriate situation. And they are heroes who influence individuals due to their wisdom, due to their charisma and intelligence. Leaders who utilize their power in a way that had a decisive historical impact. And some of these people we mentioned to include our own Osagyefo, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. We had Nelson Mandela.
Hello, this is Ewan Okugamo calling from the Math Department.
Yes.
Please, I think the great man theory has isolated great men who have succeeded in leaders. Perhaps they arose due to the environmental situation and then judge them as having innate traits. For instance, when you take Abraham Lincoln as a leader, initially in his earlier childhood might not have been leader, but the situation called for him to become a leader. Does that doesn't mean he was born a leader?
You're asking, does that necessarily mean he was born a leader?
A leader, according to the great man theory, making him an instance of a great leader who was born a leader, although earlier his life does not seem to be a leader.
Right. Considering the tenets of what culminates into a great leader, look at the theory.
Yes.
Then it implies that that person was born a leader. So,
okay.
If you look at some of the criticisms, this is something that, like the earlier caller asked, when a child is born, what are the things you are going to look at to say that, oh, he's going to be a great leader? So, if you look at this American great leader, during his early years, you couldn't see anything that we can talk of a leader within him. But maybe because they were inborn, we will say that as he grew, those things started manifesting and he became one of the great leaders. But of course, there are criticisms to this because these things or the theory is not scientifically based. So you have those kind of criticisms against that. Hello? All right, so as we await your calls,
hello.
We may be talking a bit about the great man.
Okay.
All right.
Hello.
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 Good morning. Please, my name is Cynthia from the Mathematics Department.
Yes, Cindy.
Yes, so I think that the great man theory is excluding women from it. And we know that from the olden days, we have women leadership that also came with those leadership traits. But I don't understand why they're excluding women from that particular theory.
Right, that is a very good question. Yes, you realize that during those times, things haven't developed as we are having as at present. Businesses were run by men. Kinship was led by men. Almost everything that we had within that particular community were all by men. That doesn't mean that there weren't any great women. But just as maybe in some biblical writings, we only talk of the man, it doesn't mean women were not taking activities or were not involved in various community tasks. But maybe they couldn't be counted as among the lot. So everything man is what was seen. But of course, there were great women. Yes, this great Indian woman, the name I've forgotten, Mother Teresa, I suppose. Yes, she was a very great woman. But it wasn't during those times. We are talking of the 1840s. So you can imagine. But in present times, we have some modern theories that include women who are leading. So maybe to satisfy ourselves, we will say that the great man theory is the man as used there, or the men as used in there, could be universal. But we still have it that some of these things, we were not seeing women taking part so much around that time. That's why we normally refer to the great man. Hello? Hello?
Hello, good morning. Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, hello, good morning. Hello?
Hello, good morning.
Good morning, I'm John Stamapi from Art Education.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I would like to find out, looking at the theory and the theory, can we now draw a conclusion that the trait theory is a modification of the great man theory, where they all argue that leadership qualities or traits can be acquired.
I think we mentioned that and went on to say that according to the trait theory, people are either born or made. But the great man states emphatically that the individual leader has all the qualities of leadership inborn. They saw the characteristics of that leader to be innate. So we see the trait theory to be a modification of the great man theory, where they are talking of the innate abilities coupled with learned aspects of the leader. Please, are you there? Yeah, so as explained, one is saying everything is innate, and the trait theory comes in to say that yes, the innate abilities are there, yet other abilities are made. That's why they say that you could have all these characteristics, but as time goes on, there ought to be modifications, there ought to be changes due to the fact that you learn from the environment, either to move from better to good, or good to bad, or from bad to worse. That is what the environment is preparing you to become. So there are modifications. Our time is tick-tocking, so if you have something to say, just call in 050-392-3158 or 0332-320201. I'm so happy that there has been a woman to inquire why we have the great man theory but not great women theory. The origin of the theory, we are saying that coincided with the late 19th century or in the early 20th centuries. And as a point of fact, women were not at the forefront in areas such as business, politics. Even here in Ghana, how many women do we see them in politics? Religion and state administration during those years. Or for instance, the absence of a female prophet in history actually makes the great man theory rational. Because we could hear of Prophet Muhammad, we could hear of Jesus, we could hear of some great prophets, all of whom were men. Therefore, it can be considered as a natural condition that the theory includes a gender-based prejudice. In fact, we are in the modern times and we want to see some changes. And another criticism that the theory doesn't emphasize in any way, the harmonization of people or organizations or in businesses. How is the theory of the great man talking about harmony of individuals in organizations, or how people behave in businesses and the like? The great man theory doesn't talk about that. So I'm pretty sure that as time goes on, our women folk in the generations to come, starting from now, will also push ahead some kind of leadership theories, which could also be known worldwide. Right, we're still waiting. We have a couple of minutes to go. We have been looking at the great man theory and the trait theory. We have made you aware that the great man theory has come about. Hello? Okay. As a result of leaders being identified as having characteristics that are inborn. Said leaders, we saw them to be exceptional individuals. They were born with innate qualities and they were destined to lead. And according to the great man theory, said leaders are basically male. We see them to be individuals who are well built and will rise when confronted with the appropriate situation. We looked at the criticisms of the great man theory, where we say that heroes are simply the product of their times. You could be identified as a leader during those times. Of course, today we have men who are well built, who are intelligent, but they are not leaders of our nation, they are not leaders of organizations, they are not leaders in politics and the like. And their actions are results of their social conditions. Attributing historical events to the decision or the decision of individuals was something that was primitive, it was childish, and of course it was unscientific to say that certain things might have come about due to the person's innate abilities. Another criticism is that it proposed a gender bias to leadership, that leaders are only men. We got on to the trait theory, where we said that leadership does not in any way come from birth, and leadership characteristics can be gained and or it can be learned. What distinguishes the leader from other people is that the leader has a whole set of congenital and subsequently acquired characteristics. There are criticisms that have been addressed to that of the great man theory, and this led to the emergence of the trait theory that claims that leadership is not only something that is inborn, it is not only congenital, but a combination of both congenital and acquired characteristics. So we're looking at the criticisms of the trait theory. Some of the criticisms, we say that the idea that traits are inborn and unchangeable appears to be incorrect. Another criticism of the trait theory is that it is possible for a person to learn to change his or her good character or trait for a bad or worse one. And there is no one particular trait that has been found to make a person a potential leader. We'd like to pause here and adjourn this presentation to same time next week. Thank you for your audience.